biased by the result that I have got, but I hope by the end of the talk, everyone will have a fair idea about this field. So let's start. So as we all know that the universe is full of galaxies, all types of galaxies, spiral, elliptical, giant, small, irregular, dwarfs, etc. One in out of about 100 galaxies hosts an active nucleus. So when I say active, means there the central region of the galaxy is very, very bright. That's why they are called active galactic nuclei. I will show a very small video to give you one visual impression about how an AGN looks like. So let's see. So you can see this, these active galaxies are like any normal galaxies. The main difference comes in the central part of the galaxy. A donut-shaped region which surrounds the center is called dusty Taurus. And then you can see some dusty clouds, patches of clouds and gas orbits about the center. These are called broad line region clouds, because the emission which is coming from the center is reprocessed by these clouds and they re-emit in the form of lines. And we see broad emission lines from these clouds. That's why they are called broad line region. If we see further center, central view, at the center, you can see intense accretion phenomena happens where the matter falls onto the central supermassive black hole. And then the release of this gravitational potential energy in the form of radiation, that's what makes an active galactic nuclei extremely bright. And in some cases, we see some bipolar relativistic jet, which you can see in this simulation. So I'll go to the next slide showing a brief schematic of this active galaxy, which I just showed in the video. At the central region of the galaxy, there's a supermassive black hole of the mass of the order of 1 million, say tens of billion solar masses. And it accretes matter from its surrounding. The matter which falls onto the black hole forms a disk, which is called accretion disk. Then if you go slightly further far, then there are broad line region clouds. And these clouds emit prominent emission lines. So one of the characteristic feature of an AGN is the observation of emission lines in the optical spectrum. Then people have proposed that this class of sources or AGN, they are one type of sources. We see different types of AGNs. For example, if we see from the edge on view, the central region will be obscured. We will not see broad emission lines. We will see mostly narrow emission lines originated far from the black hole. So in this case, we will think that, okay, this is a different source. But if we see from a little bit close to pole on view, we can see both the central region as well as from outside. So both broad emission lines and narrow emission lines will be visible. So this kind of unification has led to people believing that there should be some obscuring material surrounding the central region, which is now we know it's called dusty Taurus. And this is not just a hypothesis. From the observation taken by the Spitzer Space Telescope and maybe I think from the Hubble Space Telescope also, in the nearby low luminosity AGN, this dusty Taurus has been observed. And this is called AGN unification, means AGN are one type of sources, they appear different because we observe them from different angles. AGNs are classified in quasars and Seyferts. So quasars are more luminous AGNs, Seyferts are low luminosity AGNs. Then AGNs are also classified as type 1 versus type 2. So type 1s are those where we are observing the source from a, you can say, close to the pole on view. So you can say perpendicular to the accretion disk axis, the viewing angle is of the order of less than or equal to say 30, 40 degree, 50 degree, not more than that. And type 2 sources are those which we observe from the close to pole on view. Then AGNs, what we see that in some of the AGN, we see nice bipolar relativistic jet. About 10 or 15% of the AGN show this kind of feature. And these, then one of the prominent observational signature of the presence of the jet is the strong radio emission. So the definition came for the presence or absence of the jet comes from the radio loud versus radio quiet engine. So it's a synonymous, both terms are synonymous, radio loud versus or say jet or radio quiet versus no jet. So I work mostly on the sources which have jets. So, and we see that, as I said, one in about 15 AGN host bipolar jets, and about 1% of those jets are pointed towards us. So means like observer is standing close to the jet axis directly. And these sources are called blazars. And people have tried to study the host galaxy environment of these sources which host powerful jets, and it was found that they are almost all the time, whatever, whenever people observed, they found that they are associated with massive elliptical galaxies with a central black hole mass easily exceeding 1 billion solar mass. So very massive black holes residing in very giant old massive elliptical galaxies, they power such a huge relativistic jets. And this phenomena is called elliptical jet paradigm. So very briefly talking about the blazars, because the rest of the talk will be focused on these sources in which we are looking close to the jet axis. So as I said, these are sources in which jets are aligned close to the line of sight. So the formal definition is the viewing angle should be less than 1 by gamma, where gamma is the Lorentz factor of the jet, which gives them some idea about the velocity of the jet. So how do we know that that we are looking into the jet? So there are observational signatures, such as the observation of superluminal motion. People have observed from the long term, very long baseline interferometry observations, that there are radio component which moves in the plane of the sky with velocity exceeding speed of light. So it's a simple geometric phenomena. One can do a general calculation and see that basically these components are not moving with a velocity greater than the speed of light. This is just an observational effect. We are looking very close to the jet axis, and due to relativistic effect, this appears. Then in the radio band, people have tried to calculate the brightness temperature of the jets, and it was found that these sources easily exceeds 10 to the power 10 Kelvin or 10 to the power 12 Kelvin. So they have very high brightness temperature. These are the characteristic features for the presence of relativistic motion. So the radiation emitted from these jets is predominantly non-thermal. This means not the processes in which the temperature is not involved, such as the synchrotron. The radiation is very highly variable due to Doppler boosting, and the emission gets enhanced up to by a factor of thousands to tens of thousands due to this Doppler boosting. This is the reason that blazars are detected up to very, very high redshift, up greater than redshift 5. These blazars are further classified into flat spectrum radio quasars and BLK objects. And this classification comes based on the presence or absence of emission lines. So FSRQs are strong line quasars. And these strong lines, since these lines are produced by the broad line region, which is illuminated by the accretion disk. So if we see a strong emission line, this suggests there must be very intense and efficient accretion going on at the center. BLK objects usually show very weak or no emission lines. So there are two possibilities. One, they might have very weak or low level of accretion activity. Or second possibility could be that their jet emission is so dominant that it swamped the entire line emission. So we just see the non-thermal continuum. Anyway, if you talk about the broadband spectral energy distribution of these blazars, we see a characteristic double hump structure. The low energy hump, which peaks somewhere around a millimeter to optical UV and in some cases up to X-ray, this low energy hump is explained by the synchrotron process. And this is also confirmed from the observation of strong polarization, which suggests that the radiating mechanism is indeed synchrotron. The high energy peak, which we see, is mainly people have explained via inverse Compton process. And it was found that BLKs are low power sources. They are synchrotron dominated, means if their bolometric output is dominated by their low energy peak. Whereas flat spectrum radio quasars are very more luminous And in their broadband SED, the overall output is dominated by high energy X-ray to gamma ray observations. So we will keep these small, small things in mind, because later when I talk about the narrowline Seyfert galaxy, then we will see whether how these sources are comparable to blade glass. So since I coined the term narrowline Seyfert galaxy, so let's come to that. So Seyfert galaxy, as I said, they are the low luminosity regions, and narrowline Seyfert 1 galaxy, they are classified purely based on their optical spectral properties. So as I said, Seyfert galaxy are low luminosity sources. These are the one means they are the type 1 source. This means we see both broadline region as well as narrowline region. So in the optical spectrum, we see both broad lines as well as narrow emission lines. But the narrowline Seyfert 1 galaxy has a special criteria that their broad lines are narrower compared to the tip general broadline Seyferts. So the formal definition says that a full width at half maximum of H beta emission line is less than 2000 km per second. These sources show weak O3 emission line. So the definition is that O3 to H beta flux ratio should be less than 3, and they show strong iron complexes. Only 5-7% narrowline Seyfert ones are radio loud, which is expected, because in our conventional AGN scheme, people have proposed that Seyfert galaxy are low luminosity sources. It's more like they are like liners, they are like a dead galaxies. But a small fraction of sources are radio loud. These sources are usually hosted in the low black hole mass. They host low mass black holes. The masses are of the order of 1 million to tens of millions solar masses. And when people computed the accretion rate, that people found that the rate of accretion is very, very high, close to the Eddington, and in some cases, even super Eddington accretion was also observed. So it was proposed that these sources are rapidly accreting young systems. They are evolving very fast. And if you talk about the host galaxy environment of these narrowline Seyfert 1 galaxies, so there are lots of observations from the Hubble Space Telescope, and it was found that they are typically hosted in a spiral or disc-shaped galaxies. That is, they are the late-type galaxies, which is again supports the fact that these sources are young AGNs. So now I will come to the specifically on these sources. So since as the topic of the presentation says past, present, and future, so when I will talk first, I will talk about what we know about these sources in terms of the jet. Before last, you can say before 2008 or 2010. Then I will come back to that, what we have, how our understanding has developed in the last few years. And then in the final, I will talk briefly about that, what the next problem that we can address using these sources. So first, let's go to the past. So as I said, that a very small fraction of these narrowline Seyfert 1 galaxies, they exhibit flat radio spectrum. They are very radio loud. They show core jet radio structure in the high resolution VLBI imaging. People computed the brightness temperature. It was found of the order of very, very, very high, more than a billion degree Kelvin. And then people tried to study the variability characteristic. It was found a few sources show high amplitude flux and spectral variability. And in a couple of sources, superluminal motion is also observed. So as I briefly explained earlier, that these are the features which typically we expect to see from blazars. That is, the sources which host powerful relativistic jets. So the immediately question was raised that whether these sources are blazars. And this was the time at the beginning of early 2000s. So since one of the characteristic feature, as I showed earlier, of the blazar is that they are strong gamma ray emitters. So then in the early 2000s, people tried to look for very high energy gamma ray emission from ground-based observatory, because at that time there was no space gamma ray emission. So people tried to observe from VPL observatory, but the results were negative. There was no significant gamma ray emission was detected. So the hunt was on, but later when in 2008, when Fermi was launched, Fermi Gamma Ray Space Telescope, which was launched in 2008 June, and it started operating in August 2008, when the data started coming. Within the first 6 months of the Fermi operation, significant gamma ray emission from 4 radio loud narrow band C51 galaxies were detected, which immediately confirmed that these sources host relativistic jets similar to blazars. Because the detection of gamma ray emission is probably the strongest evidence supporting the Doppler boosting. But then comes the mystery. As I said earlier, blazars are known to be powered by very massive black holes, and they are hosted in giant elliptical galaxies. Whereas these C51 galaxies are powered by low mass black holes, and they are usually hosted in the spirals and very young galaxies. So the question comes, how such a low mass black holes and different type of system can launch powerful relativistic jets? So this question I will try to answer later, but first let us try to study the other physical properties of these gamma ray detected narrowband C51 galaxies, and let's try to compare them with what we know about blazars. So the first criteria is the variability, which is probably the most widely studied topic in jet physics. So we know that blazars are known to show high amplitude flux variability, both on long-term time scale as well as on the short-term time scale. So I started my PhD in 2012, at the later half of the 2012. At that time, this topic was very hot. And I observed a few narrowband C51 galaxies from ground-based 2-meter class telescopes from my institute, which operates in India. Its name is Himalayan Chandra Telescope. It is located in Ladakh, Henley, close to Indian-China border. So in the left-hand side, you can see this is the differential instrumental magnitude versus time within one night. So differential instrumental means we have observed narrowband C51 galaxy, and there are a couple of stars present within the field of view. So here we are plotting the difference of their instrumental magnitude. And these stars were selected in such a manner that these are the very stable stars. They don't themselves vary within the night. So with respect to these stable stars, whatever variability we will see, that we can presume it should be intrinsic to the target source. So you can see that how nice we have found variability in these sources within the night. In the bottom panel, I also show the scene that varies as a function of time. So to ensure that the variation that we are seeing in the target are not due to fluctuation in the atmosphere. And this variability study is called intra-night optical variability, or INOV. So this kind of study people have already done for blazars since 1960s, 1780s, 90s. You can see lots of papers were there. So when we compared this variability INOV feature between in blazars and narrowband C51 galaxies, it was found that these narrowband C51s also show large amplitude, more means within the night, more than 3% amplitude of variability they have shown. So this suggests that optical variability is similar to blazars. Then in the gamma ray band, one of the sources has exhibit rapid gamma ray flares. So GV flares, where the apparent isotropic gamma ray luminosity exceeds 10 to the power 48 arcs per second. This is the extreme number for blazars. So few sources, narrowband C51s, also showed this kind of large amplitude, extreme variability. And in fact, in one of the sources, I found shortest flux doubling time down to the few hours. So it suggests the emission region is extremely compact. So again, from the optical and gamma ray variability, it can be confirmed that these sources are similar to blazars. This means they have relativistic jets pointed towards us. If we talk about the broadband spectral energy distribution, so again, in the left-hand side in the middle panel, you can see the broadband SED of two sources. These sources show nice double hump structure, which is again similar to blazars. And one interesting thing, we see that the overall emission is dominated by gamma ray emission. So this gives an idea that among blazars, these narrowband C51 galaxies are more similar to flat spectrum radio quasars than BLI objects. And then there is another observational feature that we have seen from blazars is the presence of a strong curvature in the gamma ray spectrum. So you can see the right hand panel, the blue data points refer to the gamma ray spectrum of a very well known blazar 3C4P4.3. And the dotted line, this dashed line is a simple power law of it. And the red stars are the gamma ray spectrum of a narrow line C51 galaxy, which I have enhanced multiplied by factor of 10 to make a comparison. Again, the dotted line is the power law. You can see how the spectrum starts deviating from a power law above around 1 GeV or so. And the same phenomena you can see in the narrow line C51 galaxy also. So this suggests that again, the presence of curved gamma ray spectrum also suggests the similarity of narrow line C51 galaxy with flat spectrum blazars. And the second thing that we can understand from this observation is that the physical processes that power the jets of blazars, similar process, or say you can say the similar physical mechanisms also power the relativistic jets of narrow line C51 galaxies. Okay, now question comes, so these sources are blazars or CFERs? So there are a few defining features of CFERs, such as the detection of a soft X-ray excess below a few keV energy, the presence of a strong iron K-alpha line around 6 keV, and there is a strong Compton hump about 10 keV. And these features arises by the interaction of the X-ray corona emission, which interacts with the innermost region of the accretion disk, and we see this reflection spectrum. So by studying this kind of feature, we can try to understand the physics of the innermost regions of the accretion disk, which is happening almost close to the event horizon. Okay, so let's see how these narrow line C51 galaxy play in this case. So X-ray spectra of a few gamma ray detected CFERT galaxies also display this feature. You can see a prominent soft X-ray excess below 1 keV or so. But interestingly, around 6 keV or above, we do not see any other feature which we have seen expected, which we expect from a common CFERT galaxy. Means the feature which you usually see from the radio Poitiers. So this means below a few keV, this source behaves like a radio Poitiers CFERT. But above a few keV, the emission is simply power law, which is a characteristic feature of a jet. So this means we are seeing a observational signature of both radio quiet sources and jet at HEM. So this is, on the right hand side, you can see this is the zoomed SED of one of the sources. So you can see the below few keV, the radiation is dominated by X-ray corona, and as you go to higher and higher energy, the emission from the jet starts dominating. But so far, when people start studying, the number of sources are only 4 or 5. So a conclusive remark could not be made. People say, okay, there could be exceptional sources, of what the big deal. So it was the need of the hour to find more gamma ray detected narrow line C51 galaxy. So this brings me to the present, means the development that happened in the last couple of years. Oh, I will pause for a moment and I will request Rene to just let me know that whether all is going well. You can hear me well?
Yeah, fine.
Ah, great. Thank you. Because everything is so peaceful. Everything is so peaceful. I even will not be knowing if connection gets cut.
I have all no right. problem.
Perfect. So let's talk about the present. So earlier, the studies of narrow line C51 galaxies were, as I said, since the defining criteria of these sources were based on the optical spectral properties. So this means we needed optical spectroscopic survey to identify narrow line C51s. So the most common widely used is the SDSS. So earlier, using SDSS DR3 data, people tried to identify narrow line C51 galaxies, and they found 2011 sources. So till 2016, people were using mostly these 2011 narrow line C51 sample and trying to study all kinds of physics. But recently, when the more advancement in the SDSS instruments also, and then the later data region, when the number of detected sources were increased considerably large, So recently, if some of my colleagues, they took up the SGC DR12 catalog and they analyzed the optical spectrum of around 60,000-70,000 AGNs and to look for the new narrow band interferons. And they found around 11,000 new sources, which is a factor of about 5 increase in the previous sample of the narrow band interferon galaxy. So I immediately thought that, okay, let us start searching for the gamma ray detected narrow band interferon galaxy in this catalog. So then I did some cross match of these sources with the radio surveys like NVSS or FIRST, because we know that radio loud AGNs are expected to detect in gamma ray compared to non radio detected sources. And then perform the detailed Fermi gamma ray analysis on these sample of about among the 11,000 sources, radio detected sources are about, I think, around 550 or 600, which is less than 10%. And then for all the 600 sources, I analyzed the gamma ray data to search for the new gamma ray detected sources. So a total of 7 new gamma ray detected Seyfert galaxies were found with more than 5 sigma detection significant. Second, using the data taken in the first 7 years of Fermilab operation. So for the people who are not very well familiar with the Fermi, it's an all sky surveying gamma ray space telescope. It operates from 100 MeV and it detects the photons up to 2 TeV. It's a very broad wavelength energy coverage. And the data becomes public immediately. Like in the morning, the observation that you can get the data by evening. So anyone can access the data, anyone can do the science. So we analyze the data for all the narrow band interferons, found 7 new sources. And then since the point spread function or PSF of the Fermi is pretty large, of the order of few arc minute at 1 GeV. So we need to do some sorts of statistical tests to associate the gamma ray source with the corresponding radio counterpart or say optical or X-ray counterpart, where the PSF is pretty comparatively smaller. So we can pinpoint the source. In gamma ray, it's very difficult. So what we found that the radio and the optimized gamma ray positions for these sources are well within the 95% uncertainty region in the optimized gamma ray position. And then we carried out some statistical test which confirmed the association of the gamma ray source with the radio counterpart. So this means the result that we got are the results are robust. So now the sample of the known gamma ray detected narrow band Seyfert 1 galaxies are immediately doubled. We were knowing only 5-6 sources, now we know 15-16 sources. So using this enlarged sample, I decided to start a broadband study, including both new observations. We proposed our own observations from SWIFT and other telescopes, and also using the archival observations to characterize the physical properties of gamma ray narrow band Seyfert 1 galaxies, and then see that how these sources behave and how they are compared to other normal Seyfert 1s and Blazars. And to understand the Seyfert behavior, as I showed earlier, that they are mainly show interesting features in the X-ray band, we performed a specific study using data from NuSTAR, which is the first focusing hard X-ray telescope, then Sujaku and XMM Newton. And then on the broadband data, we carried out one zone leptonic radiative modeling, synchrotron and inverse Compton radiative modeling to see that understand the property of the jet, to study the SED parameters and then how they are comparable with what we know about Blazars. So let's briefly talk about the X-ray results. So you can see in the left hand side the plots. These are the histograms of the broken power law that we fit on the X-ray data. In fact, we found that broken power law gives the best fit for most of the sources instead of a single power law. So what we found below around 2 kV or so, the spectrum is considerably softer. The photon index is very steep, you can see. And this is an observational signature for the presence of the X-ray corona emission, as again I showed from the SED modeling. And above few kV, the spectrum is very hard. And this means we see the dominance of the jet. So basically in just between 0.3 to 10 kV observation, we see signature of both thermal emission from the corona and non-thermal emission from the jet. If we talk about the broadband modeling, then again you can see on the left hand side is the modeled SED of one of the narrow linesy photon galaxy, and on the right hand side you see the broadband SED of a very of a high redshift very powerful blazar. Please take a moment and compare both of them. You see how similar they are. Note the dominating gamma ray X-ray to gamma ray emission, which is powered by the external Compton radiation or EC. Synchrotron is peaking at a high frequency radio band, and at optical UV we can see, in some cases we see signature of synchrotron, and even the big blue bump is also observed in few cases. So this means these sources can be used to probe the young phase of the quasars at high redshift. Because this is not which I am proposing. In fact, many people have already proposed that Seyfert galaxies are probably the best candidate to study the young phase of the young phase of quasars which we see today. And from the modeling, what we found that the these gamma ray detected narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxies have a smaller jet Lorentz factors. And this phenomena, what this number which I got from the modeling, you can see on the right hand side is the histogram. The black line is the histogram for the Lorentz factor of narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxy. And in the background, I show the histogram of the same parameter which I got by studying a few hundreds of blazar in one of my previous works. So you see they are with respect to blazars, they have relatively low value of jet Lorentz factor. This implies less boosting. And this and also explain why only a handful of sources are detected in gamma ray band. Just to give you an idea that in the latest Fermi gamma ray detected source catalog, the total number of blazars is more than 3000. Whereas the total number of detected narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxy is less than 20. And now when we know that if we are detecting a source which is having a jet pointed towards us, so there must be sources with similar properties, but their jets will be pointed in some other direction. Okay, and it's a simple geometric calculation. And so suppose if this viewing angle, which is proportional to 1 by gamma, so if you calculate the how many, if we see one source with gamma, how many there will be other sources with jets in other direction. So that number comes off of the order of 2 gamma square. So this means, this suggests that if there are a very few gamma ray detected narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxy, this means a very few sources with relativistic jet. So there should be a even very smaller number of their parent population. So say for example, for blazars, the parent population is FR1 or FR2 galaxy, or say radio galaxies. So in the this sources, this class of AGN also, there must be a parent population members. And people have now proposed that the compact steep spectrum objects or CSS sources might be the parent population of narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxy. Okay, now briefly talking about the accretion jet connection, because since 90s we know that jets are likely to be powered by the accretion process. So here I show on x-axis is the accretion disk luminosity for a large sample of blazars I did in one of my previous works. And on the y-axis is the jet power computed from the SED modeling. So we see that most of the narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxies are occupied at the low accretion luminosity and low jet power regime. So the question comes then, okay, what is the reason of this difference? So one immediately thought came that since narrow line Seyfert 1s are powered by low mass black hole, so it could be due to their low mass black hole. So let's correct both quantity for the black hole mass. So when we did that, then you can see most of the narrow line Seyfert 1s are occupying a region where their jet powers are highest among the whole population of jetted AGNs. So this suggests their low jet power may be due to the low black hole mass. If we talk about the central engine properties, so you can see here on the x-axis is the black hole mass, and on the y-axis is the disk luminosity. And these quantities we have computed both from the optical spectrum, and we can also calculate by modeling the optical UV emission with a standard Sakura-Sunyaev accretion disk. So we see that first of all narrowband C4AT ones have accretion rate greater than 1% of Eddington accretion. So this suggests these sources are efficient accretors. Second thing, they also follow the same positive trend as we have seen from the gamma ray detected blazars. So now we understand this, that the accretion rate in Eddington unit is probably the fundamental parameter to explain the physical properties of narrowband C4AT1 galaxies. Because in blazars, this parameter is found to govern the overall broadband properties of more powerful relative strangers. So this suggests narrowband C4AT1 galaxies are also well aligned with this hypothesis. So now, combining all so far that I have discussed, the question comes whether these sources are young blazars. That means as the time will pass, whether these stars will shift towards the higher values. And so that's why this brings me to the very important question that is very hot now and that we will try to address in coming future, is the jet launching environment. Because gamma ray detected narrowband C4AT ones are very useful sources in this aspect because they have a very weak jet. So this means since the jet is very weak, we can see the underlying host galaxy environment and we can probe the morphology and the dynamics of the environment surrounding the relativistic jet and black hole. So this is the future. The future is the host galaxy of narrowband C4AT1 galaxies. So in this regard, actually, when I was searching for the gamma ray emission in those 11,000 sources. So one day I was randomly checking ensuring that the redshift and the other information, optical spectral information is correct. I was checking in SDCs one by one. So I came across this image. And basically this is how it all began. So you can see that this is not what I expect from a jetted AGN. I expected it to be a point source like the left one, which is basically this is a star. But this shows some sort of extended morphology. Okay, so the question came that, okay, if what is this? So it looks like some sort of extended emission, which at that time I thought it is probably a bad spiral galaxy. Maybe we are seeing the spiral arms of the source. I thought about it because narrowband C4AT ones are usually hosted in the spiral and disk galaxies. Fortunately, I got the opportunity to observe this source from the Subaru telescope later, like 2 years before. So this is what we got. And the adaptive optics enabled, this is the J-band image from the 8-meter Subaru telescope. So what we saw, for the first time, we are seeing an merger. And this is probably for the first time we have found a gamma ray emitting relativistic jet, which is hosted in a galaxy merger. So you can see the brighter one is the narrowband gamma ray detected source. This is the companion. You can see the tidal trail disruption, and you can see there is a huge envelope of dust, stars, and gas, where the both nuclei are embedded. Then we started. Along with Enrique, Paco, and Texon, and few other colleagues, we submitted a few DDTs from 4.2 meter WHT and GTC, also to acquire to carry out the optical spectroscopy and integral field unit observations. We also submitted DDT for the Chandra X-ray observations and also used some archival observations from the very large array to cover the radio part. So, We spectroscopically confirmed that merger is happening. Means both galaxies are located at the same redshift. As you can see here, the blue spectrum is for the gamma ray detected source, and the red spectrum is that of the companion galaxy. Second thing, what we see, there are emission lines in the companion. This means it also has an AGN. So from theoretical simulations, people have already proposed that mergers do trigger AGN activity. So this means we are seeing AGN activity in both nuclei. And in the absence of the broad emission lines, this companion can be called as a C4AT2 galaxy. This means it's a type 2 source. So this is a merger of a type 1 source with a type 2 source. So the question comes, whether can we say something about whether the jet is triggered due to merging activity, because we are seeing a gamma ray detected jet in this source. How about the merging environment? So on the top you see, this is the Chandra image in 0.5 to 7 keV band, and overplot is or overplotted is the contours from the J band image. You can see a bright point X-ray source, which is coincident with the optical source, which is basically the gamma ray detected object. There is some extended emission coming towards the companion, but the companion itself remain undetected. So maybe some sort of interaction in between, but we submitted proposal and fortunately we got 100 kilosecond deep imaging of this system. Hopefully the observation will take place a few months later. Now I overplotted the VLA contours. So you can see that there is a compact radio jet associated with the gamma ray detected source, no extension. And in the later, we also analyzed the even higher resolution VLBI observations. So down to milli arc second scale, the jet remained compact. So this means that even in the VLBI, we some people you have observed extended emission, some sorts of knots, etc. But in this source, we don't see anything. So this looks like jet is pretty small in length. And second thing, you see that the companion galaxy is completely radio quiet. There is no radio detection down to 1 millijansky. In fact, point even lower than that. So we have one radio quiet CFR2 galaxy interacting with a radio loud type 1 gamma ray detected source. So higher resolution VLB observations, you can see, revealed a compact jet. And then using the upper limit of the jet, using the VLBA beam size, we calculated the upper limit of the jet length. And then assuming a certain jet velocity, we can calculate what would be the kinematic age of the jet. And it turned out to be about less than 15,000 years. So jet is pretty young. Again, this is not limited only to this source. By studying a large sample of radio detected narrow line CFR ones, people have already found that these sources host very small young jet, which are still evolving. And in some sources, they may not even able to come out of the host galaxy. They are embedded within the host galaxy. So for the to get some idea about the age of the mergers and the activity, what we did, we extracted the optical spectra along the long slit observation taken with the GTC OSIRIS and ISIS mounted at WHT. We took the spectra along at 8 different parts along the slit. And then we carried out a stellar population synthesis. We masked the emission lines. So by using some stellar population models, we can calculate the extinction, metallicity, stellar population age, etc. And this gave us a merger time scale of about 0.5 to 2 giga years. And this number is pretty consistent with what people have already proposed from numerical simulations. So now if you compare the age of the jet with the merger, so we can see that jet is considerably younger than the merger itself. So this suggests that probably this is the strongest evidence that we have that jet is probably triggered due to merger. If we talk about the merging environment, these are the observations taken with the GTC Megara covering the H alpha emission region. And we in the left hand side is the H alpha flux map. You can see that there are two bright spots. One is centered at the gamma ray detected source, and this is the companion here. You can see this is white contours are from the optical image, and this is a strong H alpha emitting ring type morphology around the jet, which passes through the CFR2 and it goes towards the south of the system. If we see the H alpha velocity map, you can see random blue and red patches. This means there is no systematic rotational pattern. So this suggests a turbulent environment, maybe due to shocks, or shocks maybe interacting with the jet. We do not know. We are planning to submit a proposal from MuseVLT to get longer wavelength coverage to see to ex- understand this system in more detail. Now, so far you will be wondering that what this I'm talking about only about one source. So what's the big deal? So the point is that this is not the only source. There are a few more gamma ray detected narrow line C41 galaxies which show interesting morphology. Say on the left hand side is the pan star's I band image of one of the narrow line C41. You can see some sort of extended emission. So we have submitted a proposal to get the high resolution imaging of this system to see if we can resolve the companion and then study the morphology of the system. Right hand side, you can see this is the adaptively smoothed Hubble Space Telescope image of one the nearest narrow line C41 galaxy. You can see it's nice extended ring type of structure, which is probably the spiral arm, or maybe it is the result of a recent interaction that happened in the past time. So this, of course, this means we need to do something more to reveal these kind of objects, and definitely interesting physics is lying. Now to summarize everything, as I said, gamma ray detected C41 galaxies are the most promising candidates to understand the blazar phenomena. That is, these sources can be used to study the origin of relativistic jets. And then so far the results that we have got, they provide strong evidences that jets are triggered due to galaxy mergers. So the question is that what now we want to do? We would like to study the impact of the jet on the merging kinematics. So this means, see, mergers people have studied for many, many years. Very high resolution images are available and the observations are also taken from all types of telescopes. But for the first time, we are seeing a jet in a merger. So just to tell you the complexity, we know that galaxy mergers trigger star forming activities. But at the same time, we also know that jets are known to suppress the star formation due to strong radiative feedback. Now in this system, we are seeing both. So the point is that what is happening in this system? So for that, we need higher, more observations to reveal what is happening. So definitely this is the task that we would like to do in future. And another important point here is to enlarge the sample size, because so far we just know 15-20 sources. Enlarging the sample size may provide us new sources with even more interesting cases. So hopefully in the future when we will have more observations, so maybe I will come back with the more updates and more new results. So I will stop here and I will now take up the questions or comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Baidehi. Thank you very much for this nice talk. And I open the webinar to questions. If anyone wants to ask a question, just raise the hands or open the micro and start the questions.
Okay, we'll start. Can you hear me?
Yes, Enrique.
Okay, Baidehi, thank you very much for your illuminating and interesting talk. I appreciate now the full context of your research. It is very interesting with these new sources. I have a couple of questions. The first is, you can go to your last slide, before the future.
Okay.
The previous one. Okay, so you said that you mentioned that when these narrow line C41s evolve, whether they will go to right top end in this diagram, means larger luminosities, larger black hole masses. Did I hear correctly?
Yes. Yes. So the idea here is that these gamma ray detected C41 galaxies are the precursor of more powerful flat spectrum radio quasars.
But then there is the issue of the growth of the black hole mass. You need to increase the black hole mass by one or two orders of magnitude during this evolution.
Well, I hope I can answer you this question, but the best, I would say, would be to find some intermediate type of objects which can confirm the link between these narrow line Seyfert and in the more powerful blazar, and whether we see some sort of intermediate types of black holes. But anyway, in this figure also you can see the range of the black hole masses. So you can see that right from 10 to the power 7, it goes up to 10 to the power 9. The time scale of the black hole mass evolution, I think it, I need to think more about it. This evolution means seems possible. This is possible that these sources in future may evolve into more powerful blazars. So your doubt is that whether the black hole can grow by such a two order of magnitude or not.
Exactly. Yes. Yes.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think I need to explore this point. But I think for that we need to find more sources.
Okay.
That
was my second question. Is apart from the few sources that you already have identified and need to study thoroughly in the other wavelength regions, in the optical in particular, with spectroscopy and so on. You mentioned that intrinsically the number of sources in this stage is intrinsically small, independently of the viewing angle. So how would you go about discovering new sources?
See, first of all, for me is continuously monitoring the sky. This means as the time we'll collect more and more data, the sensitivity is increasing. We can detect fainter and fainter. So this is one aspect. Second, I think, which is more you can say promising way to go move forward would be, when we talk about a Seyfert galaxy, we are talking explicitly about the optical spectrum. If the source is H beta is narrow or O3 to H beta, like weak O3 emission, etc., etc. But when we talk about blazar, we never talk about this detail. Blazars are sources which show variability, flat radio spectrum, superluminous motion, etc., etc. So the point here is that one should carefully analyze the optical spectrum of known blazars, specifically those for whom we have found low mass black holes. And then you study their optical spectrum. A few of them could turn out to be narrow line Seyfert ones. Because blazar definition is not based on the optical spectrum. You understand, like suppose, say for example, let me share one slide, which is this. If I have not told you that the left source is a Seyfert 1 galaxy, whether anyone can say the difference between two sources, you will say, yeah, both are looks like normal blazars. What's the big deal? So the big deal is in the optical spectrum. Because these sources, the left-hand side sources, so it's specific features. They have a narrow H beta emission line. They have a strong iron complexes. But for the right-hand side, nobody cared so far. So this is a project, actually, in fact, I am working on right now. I have tried to collect the optical spectrum of almost as many gamma ray detectable blazars as possible, and then carefully analyzing the spectra of these sources and see how many of them have a narrow emission lines. These sources may turn out to be narrow line Seyfert 1 galaxy. So in this way, this is another possibility to increase the sample size. Third possibility would be, of course, the previous narrow line Seyfert 1 catalog was made based on SGC DR12. Now if you see DR14 or say now the DR16 will be coming up in this summer, the number of sources has increased, I think, by more than an order of magnitude. In the SGC DR14, the number of quasars are more than 400,000. So one has to look carefully in that in large sample and then try to find new normal Seyfert 1 galaxy, and then carry out a specific gamma ray analysis to see if we can find many more new sources. So I guess that's the way we can find new objects.
Very exciting project. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Any other question? There is no raising hands.
I'll do another comment. This could affect your last point, by the about the optical spectrum of lasers. Mm. When I was active in this field a few decades ago, the few optical spectrum of lasers were featureless. This was understood because lasers are prolonged, so it's all the, say, the broadline region emission lines would be diluted by the strong boosting relativistic effect of the luminosity. So it was even very difficult to get the redshift because they were featureless optical spectra. I don't know how the issue is nowadays. Can you comment on that?
Well, I think whatever you have said, it is correct. And it is the general opinion about the optical spectral properties of lasers. Okay. But as I said, in lasers, there are two flavors. One is the FSRQs and another one is BLR objects. So when we talk about the BLR objects, they do have a featureless continuum. We hardly see any emission lines.
Okay.
But in FSRQs, we see prominent emission light. This optical spectrum optical spectrum which I show, this is for a one gamma ray detected FSRQ. Okay, so we have seen a strong emission line. This is true.
Yes. Sorry. Yes, I got confused between BLX and blazers. Hello.
I can hear you. Thank you, Enrique.
Okay. Okay. So.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.
Any other question to Baidehi? Okay, if none, thank you very much for your time, for your energy, to explaining us all these nice results. And thank you again.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. No, thank you. Thanks.